For there is none like our sovereign Lord. Let's stand and give him all the praise he deserves. Here we go now.
You take our sins away, oh God.
Praise him, praise him, ever in joyful song. Praise can go ahead and have a seat. Hey, good morning, everyone, and welcome to Kingsland Baptist Church. Thank you so much for coming to our services this morning. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Derek Barnett, and I am the Minister of Youth and Outreach here. And I just wanted to take a couple of minutes and kind of tell you what God has been doing in our youth ministry, because it's just awesome. You know, I've been here for, I'm on my fourth year here as the youth pastor, and this year I've seen God do more in our youth group than all of the other years in the past combined. It's just been an awesome, awesome year. To be honest with you, I thought, you know, you get these ideas in your head about what you think is going to happen, and then God's like, you know, no, that's not what's going to happen at all. And to be honest with you, I really thought that this year would be a year of not necessarily decline, but I thought the attendance would kind of stay steady and things like that. But that's not that's exactly the opposite of what's happened. Our youth ministry has grown exponentially this year to where we've been seeing 80, 90. We have even skirted with 100 on Wednesday nights. And it's just been awesome to see what God's done. And then this past couple of weeks has been great as well. We went to camp, and for the first time ever, we took two separate groups to camp. We took our middle schoolers to camp 1 week, then I got to come home and sleep on Saturday, and then leave on Monday the next week to take our high schoolers to camp. And it was an exhausting time for me, but it was just incredible. We took our middle schoolers to camp a couple of weeks ago, and we saw five of them give their hearts to Christ. And then, yeah, you guys can give God a hand on that. And then last week we took our high schoolers to camp, and the majority of those who went were already Christians, and they made tons of life-changing decisions there, just awesome. You know, people discovering their gifts and people discovering what God wants for their life and all sorts of things like that. But last Wednesday night we did something that, as far as I know, has never been done at Kingsland, but I haven't been here for 100 years, so I don't know. It may have been done in the past at some point, but we had a Wednesday night youth service in here where we baptized people, because a lot of the people that come on Wednesday nights, many of them come on a bus or they come on a van that doesn't run on Sundays, and so they're not here on Sundays to be able to be baptized and things like that. And we wanted to open up the opportunity for people that have given their hearts to Christ over this past year, which, by the way, I talked about how we've had 80, 90 people, but I didn't mention the fact that so far this year we've seen over 30 people give their hearts to Christ in our youth ministry. So yeah, it's been great. And this past Wednesday night we had a baptism service, and it was just incredible, and God moved, and it was just awesome to see. Just, I'll tell you one story about this, and then we've got a video that we're going to show you about the baptisms, because it was just so awesome. I wanted to be able to share it with you guys and let you see what happened on Wednesday night. Now, I'm going to warn you beforehand that the audio is not that great on this video. On Wednesday morning, our audio, our soundboard, bit the dust. And we had a horrible hum in here all day Wednesday, and we had a bad hum on Wednesday night. And you can kind of hear that hum in the sound of the video, but don't let that distract you from what's going on, because it's just, it's awesome to see what God did. But I want to tell you one story from Wednesday night. Wednesday, we had a night where we invited the whole church to come. We invited people to come with their parents and things like that. And we had a lot of people in here. And I knew that there were going to be a lot of parents here who didn't know Christ. And so I made sure that I gave the gospel during the message. And we had six people saved on Wednesday night. And one of them was the parent of one of the teens who was getting baptized. And that night he came up and he was able to be baptized right alongside his son. And it was an awesome, awesome night. So God is doing awesome things in our youth ministry. I wanted to make you guys aware of that. And we're going to play this video now of what happened on Wednesday night. So go ahead.
See? Here is water. What prevents you from being baptized?
What's your name?
Tim.
Tim, are you a follower of Christ?
Yes, sir.
I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried in the likeness of death, raised to walk in newness of life. Go ahead and tell everyone your name.
Alexis.
Alexis, are you a follower of Christ?
Yes.
I baptize you, my sister. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried in the likeness of his death, raised in the likeness of his resurrection.
You want to tell everyone your name?
Dylan Stroker.
Dylan, have you accepted Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? I'm baptizing my brother in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, raised in the likeness of his resurrection. You want to share your name with everyone?
My name's Emily.
Emily, have you accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. You want to share your name with everyone?
My name's Dallin.
Dallin, I baptize you, or are you a follower of Christ?
Yes.
All right. I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Share your name with everyone?
Haley.
Have you accepted Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Right, then I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bearing the likeness of his death, and raised him from the dead. Right. You want to share your name with everyone?
My name's Elijah Knight.
Elijah, have you at some point in your life accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior?
Yes, sir.
All right. I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Bury the likeness of his death, and raise the likeness of his death. Do you want to share your name with everyone?
I'm Christy.
Christy, have you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior? All right. I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Share your name with everyone?
TJ.
TJ, you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
All right, then I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, raised in the likeness of his resurrection. Right, you want to share your name with everyone? Hunter, have you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior? Baptize you, my sister, and want to cover your nose there. Baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. You want to share your name with everyone?
I'm Justin.
Oh, Justin, don't trip. Justin, are you a follower of Jesus Christ?
Yes.
I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. You want to share your name with everyone?
Damien,
are you a follower of Jesus Christ?
Yes.
I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, raised to walk in newness of life.
Adam,
have you accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior?
Yes.
I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Bury the likeness of death, raise the walk in newness of life. You want to share your name with everyone?
Jeff Cox.
Jeff Cox, you accepted Christ tonight, didn't you? Raised to walk in newness of life.
Well, praise God indeed. Let's stand and worship our Lord and Savior. Are you thankful for his love today? Say amen.
Amen.
You have my heart, and I am yours forever. You are my strength, God of grace and power, and everything you hold in your hand.
I can't understand. Praise you, God of earth and sky. How beautiful is your unfailing love. Unfailing love. And you never change, God, you remain the Holy One and my unfailing love. Unfailing love. You are my rock, the one I hold on to. You are my song, and I sing for you. And can't understand. Praise you, God of earth and sky. How beautiful is your unfailing love. Unfailing love. And you never change, God, you remain the Holy One and my unfailing love. Unfailing. I can't understand. Praise you, God of earth and sky. How beautiful is your unfailing love. Unfailing love. And you never change, God, you remain the Holy One and my unfailing love. Unfailing. Unfailing love, unfailing love.
Sing with me now. Your love, oh Lord, reaches to the heavens. Your faithfulness stretches to the sky. Your righteousness is like a mighty mountain. Your justice flows like the ocean's tide. I will lift my voice to worship you, my King. I will find my strength in the shadow. Your faithfulness stretches to the sky, and your righteousness is like a mighty mountain. Yeah, and your justice. I will lift my voice.
Your faithfulness stretches to the skies. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be.
We thank you, Lord, that we can be here today with another opportunity to worship you and to praise your name. And I pray, Lord, that your message, that it will be a blessing and a challenge to each one of us. And we thank you, Lord, for blessing us with the means to return a portion of what you've blessed us with. And I pray now that you'll bless the service and the offering in Christ's name.
God will make a way where there seems to be no way. He works in ways we cannot see. With love and strength for each new day, He will make a way. God will make a way. By a roadway in the wilderness, He'll lead me. And rivers
Janet, thank you, choir. Thank you, praise band, Chris. It's good to have you here today. We need to pray for Chris and Amy. They got a baby coming any minute. And we might have a whole scene here at some point if this thing, we need to pray for them right now. You know, some of you need for God to do something. God will make a way for you. And right now where you are in life, you really need for Him to make a way for you to get through what you're going through. We have a lot of folks that are in tremendous need right now. We have folks that are grieving. Yesterday, as all of you know, we had Sharon Irby's homegoing service right here yesterday afternoon. And I want to stop and pray for them, the Irby family, Randy and David and Megan and Lindsay and Helen. And there's a whole lot of hurting people right now that are going to miss her an awful lot. And we have folks that are laid up in the hospital, folks that have tremendous need. I want to ask you right now to just bow your heads and close your eyes with me. And you may not have a major need in your life. And if you don't, man, fantastic. Lift up those ones that do. But maybe there is something going on in your life right now where you really need for God to intervene and make a way for you to get through it. Why don't you just take that to the Lord? Cast your cares upon Him, knowing that He cares for you. And Lord, I pray for these ones we've mentioned. Certainly Amy over here, she's ready to deliver. She's been through a lot. Lord, I just pray that you help her to feel better. Thank you that they're here after all they've been through this morning. Lord, I pray that you would just comfort her body, help her to feel better, and that this beautiful baby will be born uneventfully sometime soon. Lord, I think of Jan Davis and all she's gone through this week. I pray that you just touch her body. For Virginia Spivey and so many others. Lord, the list just goes on and on. Ray Cash, Clyde Jesse, John Stinson. Lord, I pray that you just minister healing and comfort and just wrap your loving arms around these folks who desperately need a fresh touch from you. Lord, you're the God who heals, and we pray that you would. And Lord, I pray that you'd make a way specifically today for the Irby family, for them to get through the grief and the heartache they're going through. Lord, we're all going to miss Sharon an awful lot, and we loved her an awful lot. And we just ask, Lord, that you would help them as they mourn, bring them through their grief. And Lord, may we, their church family, just wrap our arms around them and serve them and love them and minister to them, not just this week or this month, but for years to come. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Turn your Bibles over to Acts chapter 2. And we're right in the middle of a powerful sermon by Peter. We started it last week. We're going to finish it today. And I've entitled this message, Old School Preaching, because Peter just went off on these people in Acts chapter 2. He started with the prophecy from Joel, and we're gonna kind of start from there and move through it today. And I tell you, those baptism videos, it was awesome being here. Watching on video just got me all choked up again. That was phenomenal. Listen, if that doesn't get you fired up and get you cranked up, you got a problem, okay? That was awesome. Thank you, John Smuda, for putting the video together. And man, what an answer to prayer. We say that we pride ourselves, that we focus on, that we are all about connecting people to Christ. Listen, when we hit the bullseye right in the bull, man, we need to be excited about that. I hope that you're excited about that. And the gospel has been preached in a variety of forms, whether it be through basketball camp or upward camp or summer camp or VBS coming up. It's preached in here all the time. Listen, we need to pray for people to respond. And when they do, man, that's an awesome thing. The angels in heaven rejoice, and so should we. And now comes, we're just at the beginning, folks. Now comes the task, the obligation of discipling all those ones that have come to Christ. It's a big job. I hope that you'll get engaged with it. And that's exactly what Peter's doing here. He's preaching a powerful, powerful message in Acts chapter 2. Now, the gospel's 2,000 years old, but it never goes out of style. Isn't that true? It's 2,000 years old, but it's never, ever going to go out of style. It is just as relevant today as it was 2,000 years ago. We talk about, oh, things are so terrible today. Everything's going down the tubes, and they do seem to be. I mean, there are a lot of cruddy things going on in our nation and even in our community. But you know what? They were then too. We'll see this in the passage we're going to read today. Be saved from this corrupt generation. 2,000 years ago, it was corrupt. So it's not anything new. They were corrupt then. They're correct now. And in this passage, Peter begins to build a foundation for a new understanding of how God desires to relate to humanity. God is not distant or impersonal. If God feels distant to you, listen, he's exactly where he always was, right there, right here. He's not distant. He's not impersonal. He's available to anyone who's willing to repent and believe. And that's the message we're going to read from Peter's sermon today. To be filled with the Holy Spirit is to be indwelt by God, to be controlled by God. This crowd was full of mostly religious Jews coming for a festival. And some of them, look, they thought they were drunk. That's what it says in the text. They thought, oh, they're drunk. When the Holy Spirit descended, it so changed them. And it was, mighty rushing wind, cloven tongues of fire, speaking in tongues, and this amazing moment. Some of them missed it. But we're going to see that 3,000 of them didn't miss it. 3,000 of them caught it. and they were saved. They were indwelt with the presence of the Holy Spirit, and they were baptized in water as a public testimony right then and there. These folks came for a religious ceremony or a religious festival, but they left transformed. Now, I hope that somebody came to church today. Hey, maybe you thought it was going to be a religious ceremony, but you're going to leave transformed. And I think about people all over our community that went to church today, maybe for the first time in a long time. Maybe that's you. You're here for the first time ever. Thank you for being here. But you didn't, believe me, this is not going to be a religious ceremony. I hope you've noticed that already. I hope that maybe God will transform your life. So what happened on the day of Pentecost, AD 30? That's what I'm going to try to answer today. And instead of reading the text all the way through, we're just going to go bit by bit, okay? So what happened on the day of Pentecost? Well, number one, the Holy Spirit descended personally. The Holy Spirit of God descended personally. Now, this is different than in the Old Testament. Remember, we talked about that last week. David, my hero, King David, said, "Take not your Holy Spirit from me," in Psalm 51. Well, on this day, the Holy Spirit descended on them in a powerful and personal way. And we read later in the New Testament where they've been baptized, they've been sealed, they have received the Spirit. He'll never leave you or forsake you. And really, that's last week. The Holy Spirit descended personally. Here's the one question I want to pick up from last week, because we asked it last week. Several people responded and said, "Yeah, I need to receive the Holy Spirit." So here's the question today: has the Holy Spirit personally descended on your life? You see, when the Holy Spirit came 2,000 years ago, He didn't just barge into anybody's life. These people received the Spirit. They repented of their sins. And 2,000 years later, He's not going to necessarily knock you over the head with a bat. He's not necessarily going to hold you down and tickle you until you say, "Uncle." Now, who will convict you? And it's a powerful thing when the Holy Spirit of God convicts you. But you know what? You have to receive Him. Have you? Have you received the Holy Spirit? And really, we see this a lot with you know, well, I grew up in church. I've been a Christian my whole life. No, you haven't. Stop lying to yourself. You were born a lost sinner, rebellious, moving away from God. Just look at a baby. Watch them. We have to keep them apart from fighting with each other all the time, right? They're beautiful little sinners that need to get saved. If you're saved and if you have the Holy Spirit, it's because at some point in your life you repented of your sins and you asked God to forgive you for your sins and you invited Jesus Christ into your life to be your personal Lord and Savior. And He came into your life via the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit filled you. So that's a great question to start off with. You know, there's still water in that baptismal. It might be cold. It might even be a little funky by now. But it's still up there. We'll baptize you, just like we did Wednesday night. We'll do it right now. Have you given your heart to Christ? Have you been born again? Have you received the Holy Spirit? That's the only prerequisite to being baptized. And you can't go public with something until you've had it privately. Have you been filled with the Holy Spirit? Have you received the Holy Spirit? Has He descended into your life? So that's what's happening. The Holy Spirit descends personally. Secondly, the gospel was preached powerfully, and that's where we're going to start this morning. The gospel was preached in a very, very powerful way. Look at verse 22. Are you there in Acts chapter 2? We'll start in verse 22. Men of Israel, and I hope you're reading this stuff on your own and studying it on your own, because we can only hit the highlights here. But if you'll read this, and next week, go into next week, read chapter 2 and be, or chapter 3, and be prepared. Do your homework, and you'll get a lot more out of this, okay? Men of Israel, in verse 22, listen to these words. Jesus, the Nazarene, was a man pointed out to you by God with miracles, wonders, and signs that God did among you through Him, just as you yourselves know. Though He was delivered up according to God's determined plan and foreknowledge, you used lawless people to nail Him to a cross and kill Him. Now, this verse 23 is very interesting. We see both the sovereignty of God and the free will of man. We see, and that's a cosmic, eternal, theological debate and struggle. But in this verse here, you see that they are responsible for what they did. But at the same time, it was God's determined plan and foreknowledge for it to happen. God knew it would happen. In verse 24, God raised Him up, ending the pains of death, because it was not possible for Him to be held by it. For David says of Him. Now remember, in Christ's earthly ministry, He quoted David. He referred back to the prophecies of David. He's going to do a couple of them here. Peter is here. David, King David said, "I saw the Lord ever before me because He was at my right hand. I will not be shaken. Therefore my heart was glad and my tongue rejoiced. Moreover, my flesh will rest in hope because You will not leave my soul in Hades." Was David speaking of himself or was he speaking of his descendant? You will not allow your Holy One to see decay. You have revealed the paths of life to me. You will fill me with gladness in your presence. Now, Peter has quoted the prophecies from David. Brothers, now he says, I can confidently speak to you about the patriarch David. He is both dead and buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Since he was a prophet, he knew that God had sworn an oath to him to seat one of his descendants on his throne. Seeing this in advance, he spoke concerning the resurrection of the Messiah, the Christ, the anointed one. He was not left in Hades, and his flesh did not experience decay. Now here's where it really gets interesting. Look at this next verse. Verse 32. God has resurrected this Jesus. We are all witnesses of this. Therefore, since he has been exalted to the right hand of God and has received from the Father the promised Holy Spirit, he has poured out what you both see and hear. So Jesus has been buried. He's been resurrected. He's ascended. And now he's saying the Holy Spirit has come, just like he said he would. For it was not David who ascended into the heavens, but he said of himself. Now here's what David said of himself. And Jesus quoted this from David on more than one occasion. The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. Therefore, let the house of Israel know with certainty that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah. Lord, the Greek word, I think, kurios, which means master, God, sovereign. He's Lord. He's God. He's divinity. Get that through your thick heads, people, because they had a hard time. These people did not have any concept of a trinity of God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit of God has descended upon them. He's talking about the Son of God, and they're saying, but I thought we just served one God, Jehovah God. And he says, yeah, we do serve one God, but there's this multiplicity within the Godhead. And we can't blame them for having a hard time understanding that. But here the gospel was preached in a powerful, powerful, unique way. Now, come up to modern times. Or think of yesterday. Here are some gospel preachers. I was thinking of the gospel preachers of yesterday, who God used in amazing ways. Charles Haddon Spurgeon, D.L. Moody, Billy Sunday, Billy Graham, Adrian Rogers, Jack Wurtzen. Anybody ever heard of Jack Wurtzen? Jack Wurtzen was the founder of Word of Life. I saw him in his 80s preach to a group of about, I don't know, 700-800 teenagers. And the man, he wasn't enunciating very good. And he was strong enough to stand up and speak, but I couldn't understand half of what he said. I'll be honest with you. And he shared the gospel, I know that. And about 100 of those kids came forward and gave their heart to Jesus at that camp meeting that night around the campfire. It was an amazing experience to see how God used this man, even in his 80s, in a powerful, powerful way. Jerry Falwell, the great gospel preachers of yesterday. How about the great gospel preachers of today? I think of Greg Laurie with the Harvest Crusades and John Hagee and Franklin Graham, and Jonathan Falwell, and Tony Nolan, who I've seen preach the gospel to thousands. Of course, he spoke at our camp for the middle schoolers a couple weeks ago. And you think of these individuals who preach the gospel in a powerful way, and amazing things happen. But you know who you could add to that list? You. Me. We can preach the gospel. It doesn't have to be behind a pulpit in a sermon form. The gospel is powerful. We know that from Romans 1:16. It's the dynamite. It's the power. The power of the gospel is not in the slick presentation of the person presenting it. You don't have to be that slick. You don't have to be that cool. In fact, a lot of these people I just mentioned were odd. They were different, and they had lots of problems. But God used them in spite of it. And I think of the last spring with Operation Chesterfield. Lisa Wilson went to a door, and she talked to a young lady, invited her to come to our block party, which we do. We've done that thousands of times, and thousands of people have come. It's awesome. But Lisa just gave her the little, hey, thanks for coming. Some of you girls were with her. I forget which ones, but I know she had a couple teenagers with her that day. And, hey, thanks for talking, and got to go. And as they were leaving, she thought, you know what? That's not enough. In fact, I think the young lady was in her 20s. She had mentioned something about, they had asked, do you have anything we can pray for you about? And we were taking prayer requests, and we were praying for them. And the girl said, yeah, I have cancer. That's pretty heavy for a young lady in her 20s. And they walked away, and she said, you know what, team, we need to go back. Now, first of all, it takes a lot of courage to go up to someone's door and knock on it and invite them to church, okay? This is not easy. In fact, I remember that day I was doing the same thing, driving home thinking, man, this is not really going so great. This really isn't. My team, we had a hard day that day. And But Lisa called me and told me what happened, and boy, that really changed my mind. Lisa went back to the door for a second time, which you got to give her credit for that, because that really takes some courage to ring the doorbell for the second time. But the girl came back, and she said, you know, we want to pray for you right now. Can we just pray for you? And we also want to tell you about Jesus. And she and her team told that young lady about Jesus, and that girl prayed to receive Christ on the spot. Because the gospel is powerful. The gospel is life-changing. And God is the one that saves them. God is the one who calls them. The Holy Spirit gets all the credit. And we're just his vessels. And all he asks of us is just to be obedient. To just do what we've been told to do. And in this passage, that's what Peter was. He explains that he obediently does what God told him to do. He explains Joel's prophecy first. He says the Holy Spirit will come in the last days. And of course, at Pentecost, that happened. This is a partial fulfillment of that prophecy. There's a lot more involved in it. And there's even future aspects to the prophecy that was given there. But he goes on to reference David's prophecies there from Psalm chapter 16 and Psalm chapter 110. If you want to see the original scripture that he was referring to, you can write down Psalm 16 and Psalm 110. You'll see them. King David understood that someday he would have a victorious descendant sitting on his throne for eternity. And Peter connects the dots for them. And really, all these years later, it helps us too, because, oh, that meant this, and he connects the dots for them. He explains that these prophecies were fulfilled in the life, in the death, in the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who is now seated at God's right hand, Ephesians 1:20. So Peter preaches the gospel powerfully, but we don't necessarily need to revere Peter. The Bible never asks us to do that, by the way. Never asks us to revere a person other than Jesus. But we do admire his example and say, you know what? Any one of us can do that. You can do that. I can do that. So what happened on the day of Pentecost? Well, the Holy Spirit descended powerfully. And the gospel was preached powerfully. And then thirdly, the people responded immediately. The people responded immediately, right then and there. They took action. Peter was preaching a straightforward and unapologetic message. I want you to read along with me, starting in verse 37. Follow along here, because this is awesome what happens here. It says they were pierced. When they heard this, they were pierced to the heart and said to Peter and the apostles, brothers, what must we do? Now, you understand there's other times in Scripture where people were pierced at the heart and they got mad and they beat the snot out of Paul and some of the other apostles. Okay, so when people are pierced at the heart, there's no way to know how they're going to respond. You don't know if they're going to smooch you or punch you right in the lip. There's no way to know. But Peter did his job, and these people responded with soft hearts. So what's the answer? Well, verse 38, Peter says, repent, he says to them. Be baptized, each one of you, in the name of Jesus the Messiah for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off. Don't you love that? Man, you should circle that. Can you remember when you were far off? Can we humble ourselves just a little bit and put down the facade for just a minute and say, yeah, that was me. I can remember when I was far off. In fact, let's just go ahead and be really, really gut level honest and say, some of us in this room right now, you're far off. This is for you. You need to respond immediately. Don't put it off. Don't wait for everything to be perfect. Don't wait for someone to come and take you by the hand or pressure you with something. Listen, the Holy Spirit of God speaking to your heart today, respond. Don't harden your heart. Open up your heart, especially if you're far off. As many as the Lord God will call. And with many other words, he testified and strongly urged them, saying, be saved from this corrupt generation. This corrupt generation. 2,000 years ago, evil, wicked behavior was happening. It is nothing new. Let's not fool ourselves and think that, wow, everything's getting so bad. It's never been this bad before. Yeah, it was. It was this bad 2,000 years ago. So those who accepted his message were baptized, and that day about 3,000 people were added to them, and they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. What do? The same thing. Luke, the author of Acts, was not an apostle, but the apostle preaching here was Peter. We're still devoted to their teaching through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit in the scriptures we've been given, to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayers. That's what we should be all about. Evaluate your life based on what this says we should be devoted to. The teaching of the word, that's being disciples, and discipled and discipling others. Fellowship, that's truly knowing each other and loving one another and being a part of each other's lives. Breaking bread, can't complain about that. That's awesome. Eating together and praying together. That's what they did. That's how they responded. These folks were deeply convicted by the message. Peter serves as an excellent example to preachers of all time of what we need to be doing, what we must be doing from the pulpit, from the preacher, the ordained pastor. But that's just one. He serves as an example to all of us as we live our lives of how we should be living. He did not make a sensitive or seeker-friendly, politically correct speech, did he? Rather, he boldly preached the gospel, and the people responded immediately. You know, one sad aspect of our current culture is that we've been taught never to make anybody feel uncomfortable. We're deathly afraid of hurting anybody's feelings or being labeled a bigot or appearing insensitive, right? We hand out trophies for fifth place. Everybody with me? Has anybody got a problem with that? I don't want a fifth place trophy. If you give my son a trophy for fifth place, it's going in the trash. Maybe that makes me overly competitive. I don't know. You know, I wouldn't put it in the trash. But I wouldn't let him put it on his dresser. We tiptoe around people, even when they're involved in immorality and destroying their lives and destroying other people's lives, we tiptoe around them. We don't want to hurt their feelings. We wouldn't want them to leave the church. What is wrong with us? Shut up and stupid have been elevated to, I mean, the worst curse words you could ever say. There are children in this room who just went, I can't believe he just said those awful words. And they're bad words. Our kids aren't allowed to use them. I mean, we don't call each other names, and, or we're not supposed to. But how do we get to the point where those were the worst words you could say in public? Hell and damned are words that are only, in our culture, the only way you can use those are as curse words. It's okay to use them as curse words. People will pay good money to go be entertained and hear it over and over and over and not think twice about it. And even Christians aren't offended by it. But if you use those words, if we made a movie and said, you know what, if you don't receive Christ as Savior, you're going to die someday and you're going to go to hell forever and ever and ever. It's very real. And you will be condemned. You will suffer eternal damnation. Take that message out there and just share it with folks and see how they like it. That's offensive. Now, how much has everything been flip-flop when those two words used correctly and appropriately and biblically are offensive? But to use them flippantly as curse words is no big deal. But I will say this. It's been my experience that if we will just be honest with people and politely, respectfully tell them the truth about their eternal situation, about the Bible, many of them, not all of them, but many of them will receive it and invite Christ to come in and completely transform their lives. I've seen this over and over and over, and it's a wonderful thing when it happens. And yes, some people are offended by it. Most people, I've noticed, just think, you're crazy, you're weird, I'm out of here. They're not necessarily going to yell at you about it usually. They're not going to slam the door in your face or slap you or anything. But 1994, the summer of 1994, I went on a mission trip to Russia with about 40 other young people. Went all over Moscow and we were there for 3 weeks. And we shared the gospel everywhere we went, and it was absolutely unbelievable to watch these people respond. They had only been open to that kind of freedom, religious freedom, for a short period in 1994. We saw hundreds and hundreds and hundreds. We saw actually 1,000 people respond favorably to the gospel. In fact, we were at one camp one day, and it was a camp during the summer where kids from Chernobyl, many of them were deformed, many of them had kind of problems and so forth. There was hundreds and hundreds of them. 100 of those young people received Christ immediately that day. I'll never forget it. Can God do that now? Of course he can. Can God do that here? Yes, he can. He's doing it. It's okay. We can expect in faith for people to respond immediately. It doesn't always take a month, a week, a year, 10 years for people to chew on it. Listen, it's the gospel. It's powerful. It's life-changing. And if you're here today and you've not received the gospel yet, listen, God loves you. Jesus died for you. He rose from the grave. His blood was shed to cover your sins. It's very simple. Do you want his blood to cover your sins, or do you want to have to cover and give an account for your sins and pay for your sins forever and ever and ever? Yes, in hell. The gospel cuts straight to the heart, and it's extremely offensive. It's either a stumbling block or a stepping stone. That's what Jesus said. For some, it's going to be a stumbling block, and they're going to trip on it, and they're going to get mad. For others, it's a stepping stone. And Christ is the rock, and we like that. We like to think of him as our firm foundation, and we stand on the rock. But he's also the rock that in the last days will come and crush his enemies. We don't like to, you know, publicize that about him for some reason. It's all love and sweet and nice. And he is love, but he's also holy. He's just as holy as he is loving. And some of the people in this crowd humbly accepted Christ. And they asked, what do we need to do? What do we need to do? And Peter gives them three answers to that question. Number one, repent. Are you there in verse 37? Do you see that? Repent. Give your heart to Jesus. You cannot connect with Christ until you disconnect from the world. Are you with me? You can't. Repent means you're going this way, you stop, and you turn around and you say, I don't want that anymore, I don't need that. Here's an example. I shudder to say this because it's a little embarrassing, but when I met Elizabeth, I can remember knowing Elizabeth when I was in school. She was still in high school. I was in college. But I had a girlfriend. I remember first of all thinking, man, that girl's a lot cuter than my girlfriend. But that's neither here nor there. I dumped that girl, okay? I did not come up to Elizabeth and say, hey, you want to go out on a date with me and my girlfriend? No. And Elizabeth had a boyfriend when I asked her. Well, when we started, I didn't realize it then, but she had a kind of a boyfriend. We got rid of him, thank goodness. But it wasn't like, hey, let's all go out and have a big date together. No, it's either her and nobody else or not her, right? We can understand that in human terms. The same way with Christ. Do you want Jesus and nobody else? You can't add to your list of religions and denominations and church and Buddha and Confucius and Muhammad. And I want it all. You can't have it all. It's either him and nothing else, or just take everything else. Repent. Turn away from pursuing sin and self-centered ambitions and greed and lust and pride and pursue Jesus. And then he says, get baptized in water. That word there in verse 37 means to be dipped or immersed in water. That means go public with your decision for Christ. Some of those kids the other night got saved and baptized that night. That man got saved and baptized that night. Justin got saved years ago and has been waiting to get baptized. So some of us, you know, it takes a little longer. Some of us wait. Others, I mean, right on the spot. There's no absolute on that. We do try to make sure our children have some time to understand what they're doing before we throw them in the baptismal. I thank God for our children's leaders that help them with that and take them through lessons and so forth. But this verse is one of a handful of controversial verses in Scripture that some use to defend baptismal regeneration. But there are many other clear Scriptures that teach otherwise. Clearly, baptism was important. Extremely important. And we don't need to reinterpret or soften the verse. The simple fact is this. In the New Testament, everyone who received Christ as Savior, who physically could get baptized, did get baptized, by immersion. So someone's going, why do you have to put Baptist on your sign? What's that Baptist business? Well, it's our way of saying that's what we believe in baptism. There's a lot of different signs and a lot of different labels you could go by. But one thing we want the whole world to know is we baptize people by immersion after they've been saved. And other wonderful denominations do that too. But it's a pretty big deal. Baptism was extremely important. And this always, always, always occurs after salvation. So if you're here and you've been saved, and I'm being dead serious. If you've been saved, maybe you're here Wednesday night and you're convicted, maybe you're convicted now, I need to be baptized. Come forward during our invitation. I will baptize you right now. If you've given your heart to Christ and you've been saved and you want to be baptized, we'll baptize you today. And if anybody has to leave, you can leave. But it'll take a couple minutes. We'll get everything together and we'll baptize you today. We had 11 people planned to be baptized the other night, but we ended up with 14, one adult. How awesome is that? God is still saving souls. God is still forgiving sins. He only asks, after we've received the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, after we've been saved, he asks us to publicly identify with him. That's what we've been commissioned to do, reaching souls, connecting people with Christ. He said, go and make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. So here's the question. Why do we waste so much time and money on other things? even as a church, and I don't want to say we waste any money because we don't, but as individuals, why do you waste so much money and so much time on everything other than what God created you to do? He did not save you so that Chris and Pastor Derek and Pastor Pat could go out and evangelize, to be paid like headhunters or something. No, it's all of our job. Every one of us are equally tasked with the Great Commission. That's why we do Operation Chesterfield, and we're going to do it again in September or October. You have another opportunity to go out and get creative in reaching people with the gospel. That's why we bring in concerts or upward basketball and cheerleading. That's why we bought that great big bus. We got a great deal on it, too. That was awesome. But you know what? I've yet, and we take it up and down the pike, but and this might have happened. Clarence will have to refresh my memory if this ever happened. I don't think this has ever happened. I don't think any child has come up and said, here's $20, let's go fill her up. Of course, it'd probably take $100. I don't know what it costs to fill the bus up, but I don't think any of these kids have done that yet. They're not going to do that. We're reaching them because we love Jesus and because we're willing to sacrifice so that they can be connected with Christ and get baptized. And Lord willing, some of these kids will be deacons in our church someday and teaching Sunday school classes. How cool would that be? Maybe one of those kids you baptized the other night is going to be the pastor of this church one day. Hopefully not anytime soon. But who knows? How about Vacation Bible School? Man, investing in that and spending your time into that and coming and bringing your kids and inviting your neighbor kids. Why? Because we want to win people to Christ. This year we're going to spend $100,000, and I should say we're going to invest nearly $100,000 into missions that we could spend on everything else. We could buy more flowers, we could put more man on the wall, we could hire staff, we could do a lot of things with that money. And you know what we're going to do with it? We're receiving it, and we're sending it out. We're not doing anything with it other than funding missions work all over the planet. And I think that's a wonderful investment of our resources. Why do we do that at COE Mission Trip? And there are bigger and better and more amazing opportunities on the horizon that it's going to take a whole lot of money and a whole lot of faith and a whole lot of sacrifice for us to accomplish. So the question you have to ask yourself is, are you in, or are you more worried about being comfortable and about the next baseball game on TV and about being whatever, the American dream? Man, let's forget that. And while we're on the subject of money, I couldn't help but notice the TV preacher last night asking for money. And I didn't really hear much of the thing until he got to the money part, and I thought, you know what? I'm not saying it's right or wrong. I'm just saying, man, I couldn't imagine putting money in an envelope and sending some dude I've never met, probably flying around on a private jet, I don't know. I couldn't imagine doing that when I know that there is a lighthouse on Jeff Davis Highway preaching the gospel, taking the gospel in our community every way we can, and desperately needy, extremely worthy of it. Man, support your church. If this is your church, you need to support it. You need to give sacrificially. It's worthy. And that guy was explaining about how awesome their ministry was and all these things. They give them the money and they'll do this, that, and the other. They don't know you. They're not going to be there when you're sick in the hospital. And I'm not saying they don't care. I'm sure they do. I want to encourage you to support your church. So what did Peter say? He said, repent, get baptized. Number three, receive the Holy Spirit. Receive the Holy Spirit. Be baptized, meaning be indwelt by the Holy Spirit. This is a one-time occurrence. And then be filled with the Holy Spirit. This is a daily experience. When I met with Sharon last week on Thursday night, the last real conversation I had with her, we talked about eternity. And she was ready for eternity. She gave her heart to Christ long ago. Jesus Christ was her Lord and Savior, and the Holy Spirit lived in her life. And when she breathed her last breath on Wednesday morning, I guess about a week later, she was prepared. And I would ask you, are you prepared? Do you care whether or not your neighbors are prepared? You know, a gas engine, and man, am I getting out of my area of expertise, but a gas engine, even when it runs out of gas, there's still gas in it. There's still gas. You'd be hard-pressed to get all the gas out of an engine, out of all the lines and everything. You need to be refilled. You need to be filled. That's kind of like being a follower of Christ. When you're baptized in the Holy Spirit, you're saved. You're not going to lose the Holy Spirit, per se. But some of us need a refilling, big time. Your tank's empty, and you're just sitting there. You're not going anywhere because you need to be refilled. What did Peter say? Repent, get baptized, be filled with the Holy Spirit, receive the Holy Spirit. And lastly, number four, and we'll go home, the converts changed dramatically. The Holy Spirit came personally, and the gospel was preached powerfully. And people responded immediately, and I hope someone will today. But after that, they had to live their lives. And the converts we see changed their lives dramatically. Are you still there in the text? Look at verse 43. Verse 43. Then fear came over everyone, and many wonders and signs were being performed through the apostles. Now all the believers were together and had everything in common, so they sold their possessions and their property, and they distributed the proceeds to all as anyone had need. And every day they devoted themselves to meeting together in the temple complex, and they broke bread from house to house. They ate food with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising God and having favor with the people. And every day, look at this, every day the Lord, was it the minister of outreach? No, it was the Lord. Was it somebody's really skillful Every Believer a Witness presentation or faith presentation or some other Romans Road or something? No, it was the Lord. Every day the Lord added to them those who were being saved. Can you see how their lives changed dramatically? Ladies and gentlemen, do our lives look anything like that? Sometimes they do. Sometimes they don't. These people's lives changed dramatically. Do you remember last week I introduced you to my friend Matt? He's a missionary. Do you remember we were here last week? And Matt shared his story of growing up rough, split home, got into drugs and alcohol and a lot of stuff that really messed his life up. Young, very young. And then Christ came into his life and totally changed him. Totally changed him. He went from drug addiction and rebellion to salvation and freedom in Christ. Seminary training and preparations for career missionary work in Liberia. That's where they're heading. God dramatically changed Matt's life. And some of you have that dramatic testimony. Others of us have what might not seem quite so dramatic. But listen, if you go from being lost to being found, lost to being saved, full of sin to being forgiven, guilty to being forgiven, that's a dramatic change, regardless of what your past was. The believers change in this passage in a variety of ways. I want to list them, and then we'll have our invitation. In verse 44, they experience supernatural harmony and unity. They experience supernatural harmony and unity. And I'm to the point, because we talked about that last week, how desperately we needed to prioritize unity. Do you remember that? I'm to the point where I realized, no matter how much I love individual people and how much we all love each other and get along and all that, we don't just need unity. We don't just need harmony. We need supernatural unity, supernatural harmony. That even when we disagree about things, we do it in a loving way. And even if we don't, if we come up with a result that might be a little bit different than what Miss Bertha or Mr. Billy Bob or whoever wanted, they say, you know what, I love my church and I love my Savior and I love those people more than I love having what I want all the time. They possessed just extreme unity and harmony, supernatural. In verse 45, they looked out for each other's physical needs. They sacrificed tremendously for one another. This is not teaching communism or communal living. And by the way, what they were going through in that time was extreme because of opposing the Roman Empire and being kicked out of their circle of their religious circles as religious Jews. They were in a tough spot. They had to look out for each other. They had to look out for one another. And they sacrificed massively for one another. This is not prescribing exactly what we need to do. It's describing what they did, and it's giving us a principle now, all these years later. How do we know we couldn't be in the exact same position in the future? I mean, our economy's in a mess. How do we know we couldn't be in the exact same position where we're doing much the same things today that they were doing 2,000 years ago? Are you willing to sacrifice that much? Are you willing to do we have that kind of unity and harmony? And then they spent vast amount of time together at the temple and meeting in each other's homes. There in verse 46. They spent vast amounts of time together because they loved each other and they were learning one another. And they were at homes together. This is one reason we just did Truth Project in homes last spring. Because we need to get to know each other. We need to be the church. We don't just need to always do church. We need to be the church. But they also met together at the temple. Something like what we're doing today. I'm sure the music was a little different. The apparel was probably a little bit different. But it was the same kind of thing. They were worshiping the Lord. They were together. Last night, I had my 20th high school reunion. And it was, I don't know, I didn't go. I went to the 10th and it was horrible. I swore to myself I'd never go to another one. Elizabeth wouldn't let me go. And my daughter had a birthday, and so we did her birthday instead of my 20th reunion. But it dawned on me, and I almost felt like crying last night talking to Elizabeth about it. I have nothing in common with those guys. I don't even know hardly of them, any of them. Facebook has reunited a few friendships, but not many, and I don't ever even go back there, and I know it was going to be going on at the big reunion party, and I just couldn't go. I didn't want to go, and I didn't go. I can tell you, I really look forward to our little reunion this morning at 11 o'clock that we have every single week, being with people that I love, being with people that I care about, people that care about each other, that have something in common. We're all different. We're different colors, different backgrounds, different way of talking, different socioeconomics, but we have Jesus in common. That's the way it ought to be. And then in verse 47, they worship Jesus, and God just kept adding more and more folks. Because let's think about it. Who wouldn't want to be in a group that got along really well? Who wouldn't want to be in a group that when you had a physical need, they helped sacrifice to meet your physical need? Who wouldn't want to be in a group that loved to spend vast amounts of time together eating and hanging out and fellowshipping? Who wouldn't want to be in a group like that? You know, why do the Bloods and the Crips exist? Do the Bloods and the Crips still exist? I might be a little old on my gang terminology there, but why do they exist? Because the people want a place to belong and look out for each other and care for each other. That's why. Listen, there's no weird initiations here. You don't have to go beat anybody up or rob a bank or anything. Just give your life to Jesus. And the outside world was impressed by them. Do you see that there? They had favor with all the people. I love that. They had favor with all the people. In other words, they didn't look at them as a bunch of religious snoots that walked around saying, "I'm better than everybody," and condemning everybody. They had this early group of Christians had favor with those who are outside the church, just like we should today. So what happened here? Well, the Holy Spirit descended personally into their lives. And the question as we close is, has the Holy Spirit descended personally into your life? The gospel was preached powerfully. When was the last time you shared the gospel with anybody? It's convicting, isn't it? The people responded immediately. Maybe we as Christians here need to say, "Lord, you tell me what you want done, and I will respond immediately. Tell me what you want me to do right now, and I'll do it." That's a pretty scary thing to do. What if God wants to send you to Liberia with my buddy Matt? The converts' lives changed dramatically. Would you pray with me? Has your life changed dramatically? Maybe the truth is you need some dramatic life change. You don't necessarily need another trip up to the altar or anything like that, New Year's resolution or any of that kind of stuff. You just need to, there's some things that just need to change. You know it. God knows it. Your spouse probably knows it. Your kids almost definitely know it. Why don't you take it to the Lord during our time of invitation? We're going to sing the old hymn, "I Surrender All." Surrender that. The life change that needs to happen in your life. I'm in the middle of some life change, I can tell you that. And it's day by day, it's constantly, it's not a one-time decision. It starts with a one-time decision, but it goes from there. And sometimes it takes discipline, sometimes it takes an accountability partner, it takes some time with the Lord to experience the life change. Could be your temperament, could be your temper, could be a habit. What have you done with the gospel? Have you received the Holy Spirit? Listen, we've talked about it over and over again. It's time for you to do something with it. You can respond immediately. Right now, ask Christ to come into your life. Ask Him to forgive you of your sins. Ask Him to be your Lord and your Savior. Ask the Holy Spirit to fill you up and indwell you and push everything else out. And we're going to have an invitation. If you want to come forward and have someone pray with you about that, maybe you've done it, but you want to come and request baptism. Come and do that. You don't have to do it right now. You can if you want, but you might want to join our church today and become part of a church who is dead serious about being a whole lot like that early church in Acts. Are you sharing the gospel? Are you responding to the moving of the Holy Spirit in your life? My simple invitation to you today is just to say, "Lord, help me. Lord, help me to change where I need to change. Lord, help me to share the gospel sometime, some way this week. Lord, help me to be responsive to the leading of the Holy Spirit." And Father, I pray that you would move in our time of invitation. We do surrender our lives to you. Everything we have, we lay down at your feet, even as a church. All of our resources, all of our programs, all of our buildings, they're yours. They're not ours. They're not mine. Some committee. No, they're yours. And we just ask that you would have your free will, your Holy Spirit free will to move and do whatever you want to do. Change us however you want to change us. Lead us where you want us to go. Just give us the courage and the boldness to pursue passionately. And we say, yes, we as a church, we surrender right now to your plans, your will, your desires. And Lord, I pray that you'd move in the individual hearts of men and women and boys and girls and teenagers under the sound of my voice right now. And I pray that you would affect life change during our time of invitation. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Would you stand with me? Let's sing, Come As God Leads You. I'm going to invite my friend David Wyman to come forward, and he's our Dale representative for the Chesterfield County School Board, and he's with us worshiping today, and he's become a friend to me over the years, and I asked if he would dismiss our time together in prayer today. I want to remind you, it's fitting that you're here today. We have, sorry about that, we have our Vacation Bible School starting next Sunday. So be here, bring your neighbor friends, all of you that sign up to help, make sure you help. If you haven't got your background checks and all that, get that done because we want to use you. We need all the help we can get. We'll start next Sunday and go through Thursday. So let's pray for Vacation Bible School. Let's be here. And it's fitting that we have our school board representative here. Thank you for the good work you do. We pray for you, and we appreciate all that you do up there with the school board.
It is a great pleasure to be here today in the house of the Lord, and we heard the word preached today, didn't we? But let's go to the Lord in prayer. Most gracious and heavenly Father, we love you, Lord. You provide so abundantly for us, our friends, our family, our congregation here, our church body, Lord. We're thankful for the word and the way it was preached today, Lord. I'm thankful for Brother Patton and the strong message that he gave to us today about reaching out, Lord. I'm so thankful, Lord, and we're so blessed this morning to see all the baptisms from this past week, all the work that you're doing in this church body and just adjacent to us, Lord. Lord, help us to live the example just like Peter, who reached out, Lord, to all those around him, who preached your word unfailingly, Lord. Help me, Lord, in my position. Help all of us in what we're doing each and every day. We ask these wonderful things in your holy name. Amen.
Hi, my name is Pat Fiordelise. I'm the pastor here at Kingsland Baptist Church, and I want to thank you for being with us for our video broadcast of our service. And thank you for watching. I hope that you enjoyed it, and I hope that you will get in contact with us. If there's anything we can do to help you, our phone number is 275-1285, and you can check us out on the web at kingslandbaptist.com. And we want you to know that we love you. A verse in Scripture that means a lot to me comes from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and it says that the love of Christ compels us, it constrains us, it motivates us. And that's really what we're all about at Kingsland, and that is connecting people with Christ, because the love of Christ compels us to do so. We've received His love, and now we want to share His love all over Chesterfield County. And maybe tonight you have questions about your spiritual destiny and whether or not you're on your way to heaven ultimately with your life. And I would encourage you to think about that, to pray about that, to talk to God about it. You see, Jesus Christ loves you. He died for you. He shed His blood for your sins. And the Bible says there's none righteous. No, not one. There's none who does good. There's none who seeks after God. So the truth about humanity is that we're born separated from Christ. We're born lost, and we're really born dead, spiritually speaking. And what we need to do is to be born again. That's what Jesus said. You must be born again. And he made that possible by dying on the cross for our sins, being buried, and raising from the grave 3 days later. And you know what? That can become a reality in your life. Tonight, if you want to invite Christ into your life, do that. Ask Him to forgive you of your sins. Ask Him to be your Lord and your Savior, and give your heart to Jesus. And what we're here to do is to help you, help introduce you to Christ, to connect you with Christ, and to help you grow. And that's why we have our television show every Friday night. And that's why we have services here at Kingsland every Sunday. We have Bible study at 9:30 every Sunday morning. And we have a worship service at 11 o'clock every Sunday morning. And we would love for you to come and sing and learn and grow in your faith. If there's anything we can ever do for you, contact us here at Kingsland, 275-1285. And we hope to see you soon. God bless you.
You held out your arms.